Okay, so those of you who attended the workshop, this is the scene that I showed you how to make. I didn't really render it out because I don't know why I didn't render it out, but anyway, this is the scene that we are going to be making, and I'm just going to open a new file so that you guys can follow along. So once you open a new scene in Blender, this is what it's going to look like. Okay, so I'm just going to click somewhere over here to remove that splash screen. It's called the Blender splash screen, and I am going to start modeling. So I'm going to start off by removing everything, and just before that I'm just going to turn on these so you can see what I'm doing over here. Gee, yeah, it works. Anyway, okay, so I'm going to select everything by either dragging and selecting or by pressing A. A to select all, Alt A to deselect. So I'm just going to select everything except our light because we're going to need it. Press X to delete, and we're going to start modeling. So for that, we're going to get a reference image which you can find in Google. I've already downloaded it, so I'm just going to import it by pressing Shift A to add a new object. Come down to image, reference, and just go to the place where you've saved it. I've saved it on my desktop, so from there. And I'm just gonna move it around so that this part of the cup is aligned with the x-axis. So G to move, hold down Shift, and yeah, right about there. Okay, next we're gonna start off with the basic shape. So to create any object, any drawing or anything in general, you're going to need a basic shape. And the basic shape that we are going to use for this is a cylinder. So Shift A, mesh, and cylinder. Now to see things more clearly, I'm just going to turn on X-ray view. The shortcut for that is Alt Z, as it's written there. And I'm going to press Tab to enter edit mode. So what edit mode does is it allows us to edit different parts of the mesh instead of the entire mesh as a whole. So I'm just going to select these top vertices, G and Z to move it along the Z direction and align it with the top. I'm going to select the bottom vertices, Z, Z, and align it right. Right about that. I'm gonna select all G, X, and move it slightly to the left. Press Tab. Okay. Just gonna select these bottom vertices. Press S to scale. Just basically trace out the shape of the reference image that you have here with the mesh. Press E to extrude. What extrude does is it creates a new set of vertices which you had selected and extrudes them out of your mesh. So I'll bring it there. Press S to scale. There. Extrude. Scale. E to extrude. And scale it down. E. S. And that's it. We have our cup. If I turn off X-ray view, you can see that this entire thing is a solid mesh. But then, if you look at a cup, this top part is hollow. So I'm going to go to face select, which is the third option here. Select the top face and press X to delete it. And choose face. Okay, so I'm just going to go out of edit mode. Select my reference image, press G and Y to move it back so that it doesn't affect our, I mean, it doesn't cover any part of the mesh. I'll go back to my cup. And if you look at this now, it has this low poly jagged shape. Yeah, shape. So to smoothen it out, that we can use something called a modifier, and modifiers are basically things that affect your mesh automatically, so that you don't have to manually do those operations. So I'm gonna choose this spanner icon here to go to the modifiers tab, add modifier, and I'm gonna add subdivision surface. So what that does is it takes two faces and it kind of adds more faces in between them and averages out the shape so that you get a smooth structure. I'm going to increase the viewport display to 2, right click and shade smooth. Okay, so now we have a smooth cup except for this bottom part here. And to counter that, I'm going to go back to front view, 1 for front view, 3 for side view, 7 for top view. So these are 3 pretty important shortcuts. So go to front view, tab into edit mode. Just gonna turn on X-ray, or actually we don't need X-ray. And I'm gonna add a loop cut. So what a loop cut is it adds a loop of edges or vertices depending on which is selected. So it's gonna add a loop of edges into your mesh, and how that affects the subdivision surface modifier is it adds more geometry to smoothen out. So you can see that practically when you apply it. So to add a loop cut, press Ctrl R. I'm gonna hover my cursor here because I need it here. Left click to confirm it. Move my cursor down to the very bottom right there. And left click to confirm that location. So if you look at that, you can still see this weird flowery pattern on the bottom. So to remove that, I'm going to go to face select, select this bottom face and press I to insert it. So once you do that, one thing I like to do is E to extrude and extrude it up just a little bit, and then I again to insert. So we have a cup with that thing inside, whatever that's called. And any object in the real world, even if it's a piece of paper, it has a certain thickness. So to add thickness to our mesh, we're going to add another modifier called solidify. So as the name suggests, it solidifies your mesh. And I'm going to give it a thickness of 0.03 and move it up. And the reason I'm moving it up is because when you add modifiers in Blender, what it does is it executes those modifiers in the order in which they are shown here. So first we have solidify, then we have subdivision surface. So it solidifies our mesh first and then subdivides it. Yes, that's a pretty important thing to keep in mind when working with Blender and using modifiers. So I'm going to go back to edit mode and we are going to add our handle. But to add a handle, we need to select this middle face here, but we don't have a single face. And that select, we could select these two faces and extrude them out, but then it would cause problems later on in the final mesh. So to counter that, I'm going to go to top view, press A to select everything, R to rotate, and I'll hold down Control and rotate it a bit. And what Control does is it performs your operations like rotation, scaling, and moving in certain increments, right? So yeah, if you go to side view, we can select this middle face here, go back to front view and extrude it. But the problem with doing that is we have a solidify modifier to our mesh. And that would apply to the handle as well, not just this part of the cup, which doesn't really make any sense. So to counter that, I'm going to tab out of edit mode, apply a modifier. The reason we are doing that is because you can't apply modifiers when you are in edit mode. Okay, so with the cup selected, press tab into edit mode, and press E to extrude, and it might be constrained to this direction, so to counter that, press double tap Z and it will extrude it out. But if you see here, you have two faces which got extruded, and that's because this solidifier, I mean, that's because the solidifier modifier got applied and those two faces were selected when it was being applied, if that makes sense. Anyway, to counter that, go to side view and just select this face and press E to extrude. Again, double tap Z to remove the constraint, S to scale it down just a little bit, R to rotate, and press E to extrude. Scale it down, G to move it up, rotate it a bit, and press E to extrude it again. Rotate, G, and then. Now we could keep doing this, extrude, rotate, but that wouldn't make any sense because Blender already has a shortcut for us which can make our lives easier, and that is the spin tool. So to use the spin tool, how the spin tool works is above it, spins our selected face about a specific origin point, and our origin point right now is over there, which we don't want. And to move the origin point to our desired location, you can either hold down shift and right click at your location, or you can choose this option here, the second option, it says cursor. So with the cursor option selected, I'm gonna click right there and choose my spin tool, and I'm gonna drag it and okay, so for some reason Blender just automatically decided to crash and I had forgotten to save my file. So I just redid all that and we are back here. Always remember to save your file. Anyway, so with our spin tool selected, I'm just going to drag this out to somewhere there. And if you look at this mesh and the reference image, it doesn't really, it's not really aligned to it properly. So to fix that, I'm just going to go to X-ray view, and in the spin menu here, we can use these three options, center, XYZ, to sort of align our mesh with the reference image. So I'm going to hold down shift and move it along the X and Z axes to right about there. I'm going to turn off X-ray view, go back to box select, and I'm going to continue extruding. So extrude, rotate, move it there, extrude, move, oh sorry, rotate, extrude, move, and rotate. Now we need to join this face with this face, but first we are going to remove this face so that we don't have any overlapping faces inside our mesh. So press X, delete that face. Now Blender has a function which can be used to bridge vertices together, and that is called bridge vertices. Pretty simple names they've given you. So with vertex select, we're going to choose these 8 vertices which we want joined. So that 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8. Yeah, so press F3 to bring our search panel and type in bridge, and there we have our loops are bridged together. But if you look at this junction here, it's a bit too smooth, whereas if you look in the reference image, it's like this slightly sharp junction. So to get that, we're going to select these 4 vertices here, press N to bring in our properties tab. Oh, I forgot to turn this on, I am very sorry. Anyway, press N to open our properties tab, and under mean crease I'm going to type in 0.5. If you see that, we have something better. And we're going to do the same thing here as well at the top. N mean crease 0.5. Yeah. But then if you look at the shape, it's sort of weird. So I'm going to correct that by going into edit mode, turn on X-ray view, select these vertices and scale it down just a little bit and move it up. I'm going to do the same thing with these bottom vertices as well. You can also double tap to select the entire loop. So scale it up. And there we go. But if you look at this handle, it's a bit too thin. So I'm going to correct that as well by going to edit mode, choosing face select. And I'm going to select these loops. I'm sure there's an easier way to do it, which I need to find out. I'm just gonna unselect these faces because I don't want to scale them up. And press S and Y to scale it along the Y axis. Right about there. If you look at that, we have our cup. Now to model the plate, every object has a basic shape, and for the plate we can use a circle. So shift A to add a new object, mesh and circle. Okay, since our origin point is there, it adds our circle there, which we don't want. So Control Z to undo, and we want our origin point to be at the center of this cup. So with our cup selected, press shift S and choose cursor to selected. So if you do that, the cursor comes to the center of the cup. So now if you add a circle, it gets added there. Perfect. Okay, so I'm going to go to edit mode with the circle selected and press F to add a face right there. I'm going to go out of edit mode again. Press G and Z to move it down along the Z axis. To, I think right there would be fine. Go into edit mode again and scale it up to, yeah, somewhere there. Press I to insert it. And now we're gonna add more loop cuts so that we can make a better shape for this. So Control R to add a loop cut. And using your mouse wheel, you can choose how many loop cuts you want, and I'm going to choose 5 because I think that gives a better shape. And I'm going to select this innermost loop and bring it down. But if you do that, it brings down only this inner loop, and we're going to have to do that over and over again for each of these loops. And Blender has another function which can make our life again a little more easy, which is called proportional editing. So what proportional editing does is it affects not just this one part of the mesh, but in an area. So if I press G, you see this circle around our cursor. So that shows how much of the mesh it affects. So you can scroll up or down, and if you see that, it affects certain areas of the mesh. And there are different options here which you guys can explore. I think random looks the coolest, because look at that. But the thing we're going to use here is smooth. So with the innermost loop selected, go to front view, G and Z. I'm going to scroll up so that it affects almost the entire mesh. So I'm going to bring it down to approximately where the cup ends. There. Okay, that's a bit too low. I'm going to go to X-ray view so that it's a bit easier to see. I'm just going to hide our reference image so that it doesn't cause any problems. So G and Z to move it right there. Okay, perfect. I'm just going to scale this down to, okay, turn off proportional editing first and then scale it down up to where it just touches the cup. So if I bring back my reference image, if you see this area of the plate, it has this weird, well, not weird, it has this extrusion so that you can place your cup in that easily and it doesn't wobble around, I guess. So to add that, by the way, you can use these eye options here to hide objects, or you can select your object and press H to hide it. And if you press Alt H, it will bring back all the hidden objects. So I'm just gonna hide my reference image and go back to my plate, tab into edit mode, and I'm gonna add two loop cuts. So Control R, scroll up, and we'll add two loop cuts. I'm just gonna bring it down right there. I'm gonna select this middle loop, press G and Z to bring it up right about there. So now we have our basic shape for the plate. If you look here, you can see this weird thing, and what that is the cup. So to remove that, select your plate, press G and Z, and move it down up to where it's not seen anymore. Now to smoothen our plate, again, in the same way that we did for the cup, I'm gonna add a solidify modifier, give it a thickness of 0.03, and add a subdivision surface modifier with a viewport display of 2. With the plate selected, right click and shade smooth. Now if I hide my cup, you can see that same weird pattern that we had on our cup. So again, to clear that, I'm gonna go to wireframe mode, select my face and insert it. Now again, if you see these areas here, it's a bit too smooth, which is not really possible, or maybe it is possible, but we don't really prefer that. So go to X-ray view with edge select mode, double click on this to select the entire loop, press N to bring up properties tab and mean crease of 0.5. similarly for the inner loop, mean crease of 0.5. press N to remove it, and there we have our plate and our cup. This would probably be a good time to start naming our objects, so double click here and type plate, here and type cylinder. And we don't really need our reference image anymore, so right click on that and delete. And now we need to start adding our materials to our objects. So to add a material, select the object you want to add the material to and go to the materials tab. Press new to add a new material, and you can't really see anything here, and that's because we are in solid view, which shows only the mesh. Now to view the materials, we can choose one of these two options, either rendered view, which is the last one here, or the material preview mode. Now the difference between these two is, material preview mode by default, it applies a sort of environment lighting around your object, so that you can see the materials more clearly. Whereas in rendered view, it will show the object with the materials with the lights present in the screen, right? So the one we're going to prefer to view the materials is this material preview. Now I'm going to give this a sort of ceramic or porcelain material, whatever they use for it. So for that, I'm going to bring the base color up to 1 and bring down the roughness to about 0.1. Okay, so now we have a shiny ceramic cup. And we can do the same thing for the plate by selecting the plate and adding a new material, or we can just copy the materials from our cup to the plate. So select your plate, select the cup, press Control L and choose materials. So that will make a link between your plate and your cup with the materials. So if you change the material of the cup, it will change it for the plate as well, and vice versa. So now I'm going to add a sort of a golden ring around the top of our cup. So to add that, press this plus button here to add a new material. Press new. I'm going to give this a base color of, say, that. Bring up the metallic, and I'm just going to give it roughness of 0, because I like smooth metals. Anyway, if you look at our cup here, it doesn't really have, you can't see that material here. That's because we haven't assigned the second material to any part of our cup. So to do that, select your cup, press tab to enter edit mode. I'm going to add an extra loop cut here so that we can give it a thin ring instead of moving this up, which would change the shape of our cup completely. So Control R, add a loop cut, go to face select, select this loop and assign. Sorry, tap out of edit mode. You can see that our cup has that golden area. I'm going to do the same thing for the plate as well. So tab into edit mode, select this loop, and we need to add a material here. So press new, and we could either do the same thing over and over again, or you can choose this drop down menu here and select material number 2. So with this loop selected, press assign, and there we have that. So now we've modeled and textured our cup and our plate, and we need to do the same thing for our tea as well. So I'm going to go back to solid view, and to create the tea, we could either do one of three things. So the first and the most basic thing which would come to mind is add a cylinder, place it in the cup, and model it according to the shape of the cup, which is pointless and inaccurate and is a waste of time. The second one is through fluid simulations, which is a very important and pretty cool aspect of Blender, but then we're not going to use it here because fluid simulations require a lot of RAM, it'll take a lot of time to generate the simulation, and it's something for a later topic, not for this exactly. And the third one, the easiest method, is since we have our cup, we can choose a certain part of the mesh of the cup and use that for the tea, which is what we're going to do. So with the cup selected, press tab to enter edit mode and choose X-ray view. But if you do that, you can select your loop. But the problem with that is you by mistake might select the outer loop, which I have done here. So an easier way to do that, or a simpler way you could say, is go to wireframe, turn off X-ray view. And again, you have this weird complicated mesh here, and that's because our subsurface modifier is activated. Is enabled, not activated. So to disable it in edit mode, choose this third option here. And these options, what they do is they enable or disable your modifier in certain modes. So the first one is rendered, second one is viewport, third one is edit mode, and the fourth one is something which I have never used until now. So I'm just going to choose disable in edit mode, and I'm going to select these faces. Double click to select those loops, and this might take a little time to get used to, and there we have our selected loop. So I'm going to press shift and D to duplicate this mesh, right click to reset its location, and press P and choose selection to convert this to a separate object. So if I tab out of edit mode, go back to solid view, choose my cup here and rename it to T, which is very important, and also save it because I don't want Blender crashing again. So with the T selected, tab into edit mode, and you can see that it's hollow and T isn't, well, hollow. It's sort of this, it's a fluid, right? But in Blender, we can't really show that right now because we haven't done fluid simulations. And we're going to model this as a solid object. So with in edit mode, I'm going to go to wire X-ray view, choose that, which is edge select. I keep forgetting the name, not sure why. Choose this outer loop and press F to add a face over there. So if you turn off X-ray view, you can see that you have a face. Now if I tab out of edit mode, you can see that same problem which we had with the cup. So to counter that, I'm going to go back to edit mode, press I to inset it, and there we go. It's still a bit weird and you can work on that a little longer, or you could just leave it as it was, but I worked on it a little longer because I have no idea why. Anyway, to add a material, we're gonna go to material preview. If you look at our T here, it has this white and golden color in the material list, and that's because we modeled the T from our cup. So automatically, along with the mesh, the materials also get added to it. So to remove that, you see this three, this number here. So that number indicates how many objects that material is applied to. So if you click on that number, it will remove that link. So if I change the color right now, it will change just for the T. I'm going to do the same thing for the gold as well and press minus to remove it. Now with this material selected, we need to use, we need to give this a sort of glassy texture. And to do that, we're going to use this transmission option that you have here. Now, there are a lot of options here which add more and more realistic effects to your final render, which you guys can explore later. But since this is a sort of beginner tutorial, I'm not going to delve deep into those right now. So under this transmission option here, I'm just going to bring it all the way up to 1, and roughness, I'm going to bring it all the way down to 0. If you look here, it looks like this weird mirrory thing, and that's because the material preview option uses something called the EV rendering engine. So there are two main rendering engines that we use, EV and Cycles. The difference between them is Cycles takes more time to render in the viewport and in general, but has more realistic textures, so it's basically worth the wait. But in EV, you can see almost what it would look like in the final render, but in real time. I mean, that's one use of EV. There are many other uses of EV which I'll talk about in a later video probably. So I'm going to, under rendering engine, I'm going to choose Cycles and go to render view. So if you see that, we have our glass. To see it more clearly, I'm just going to select my cup and my plate, press H to hide it, and we can't really see it. So I'm going to add a play, I'm going to add a base, so we can see our glass, more clearly. But if you look at that, it has this weird reflection type thing going on. That's because of the way the normals are aligned. So what a normal is sort of like this imaginary line, you could say, coming out of the mesh, coming out of each face of the mesh in the direction that it's facing. So it could either be facing outwards or inwards. So to check if it's aligned correctly or not, you could go to this overlays tab here, which is a circle in a circle type thing. Choose this drop down menu and click face orientation. Now if you see that, we have this red and blue type color scheme. And what these represent is the way the normals are aligned. And blue represents correct and red represents incorrect. So to correct this, select the T, tab into edit mode, press A to select everything, F3 to bring in our search tab, and type in recalculate normals. So if you do that, it's aligned perfectly. It's gonna go back here, turn off face orientation, and if you go to rendered view now, it's perfect, like glass. Now we need to give this the color of tea or coffee. I'm just gonna go for coffee, although I'm a tea person, because you can get a darker color with coffee which looks a lot better personally, which I feel. So I'm just gonna give this that color. I'm gonna press Alt H to bring back my cup and my plate. If you see that, we have our tea along with the cup and the plate and the base. So with that, our modeling is complete, but I'm just gonna bring my plane or the base up a bit so it doesn't look like the cup is floating. Anyway, so now if you look at our shadows here, it's a bit too sharp, and that's not really what we want right now. Or at least it's something I don't prefer. So I'm gonna zoom out, select my light, and under this bulb option here, I'm gonna increase the size. And what that does is, if you look at any shadow in general, the size of the light the size of the light shows how harsh or how soft the shadow is. And not just me, photographers in general, they prefer softer shadows depending on what they're shooting. So right now I would prefer a softer shadow, and to do that, I'm going to increase the size of my light. I'm going to give it a size of 2. So if you see that, it's a softer shadow, right? I'm going to bring up the power to 1500 so that it's a bit brighter. Give a material for my base. Last time I gave green, in the render I showed blue, so I'm gonna give it pink right now. Okay, that looks terrible, so just gonna give it a blue. Okay, so now we have everything that we need for our scene. So to render it, we need to add a camera, because without a camera, your software won't know what it needs to render. So I'm gonna press Shift A. Just gonna go back to solid view first, turn on overlays, and Shift A and add a camera. Now you can press 0 to go to camera view, and then press G to move it around and choose a right location, or you could go out of camera view, find a location that you think would look nice for the final render, and press Ctrl, Alt, and 0 to bring your camera to that location. And I generally prefer to have a square picture, so under the second option here, which is Output Properties, I do not know these names. So under Output Properties, I'm going to type in 1080, so we have a nice square picture. And for composition's sake, I'm going to go to this camera option here, which looks like a camera. Scroll down to viewport display, and I'm going to go to composition guides and add center. And there are many guides here which photographers and artists generally use, like rule of thirds, golden ratio, that. But I'm going to use center here because we have only a single object and we don't need to go into complicated stuff. So press G or double tap G, hold on shift and move it to somewhere there. Now if you go to your rendered view, it looks fine. And if you don't want this other disturbances, or I consider them disturbances, if you don't want to see this part in the viewport render, press Ctrl B, drag and select that area. So now we have our scene, but then it looks a bit too sharp, a bit too crisp, which generally doesn't happen in pictures, because every camera has a specific focal object. So to add our depth of field, which every picture has, I'm going to choose depth of field, and under this option here, focus object, I'm going to choose this eyedropper tool and select T. And you could play around with the f-stop and the focal length of the lens, but I'm just going to leave it at default and see how that looks. It's a little bit sharp, I guess. So I'm just going to give it 1.4. I guess that's fine. So yeah, we have our basic scene ready with the camera, the focal length, I mean the depth of field, not the focal length, the lighting, the modeling, and the texturing. So now we are going to render it. So go to this first option here, which is the render properties, and under sampling I'm going to give it a render sample of 200, so that you get so the way this works is, the more samples you have, the clearer your picture will be, but it also reduces your render time, I mean increases your render time. More samples equals higher render time. So I'm just going to give it a sample of 200, and under this option here, which is layer properties, I'm going to scroll down and choose denoising, so that you don't have that weird grainy type effect. And under performance, I'm going to change my tile size to 256 by 256 because I'm using my CPU. So how that works is, for your CPU, you need to give a bigger tile size, and for your GPU, you need to give a smaller tile size to reduce your render time. So with all those settings done, I am going to press F12, or you can come up here and choose render image. So if you wait for a while, I have no idea why it's doing that. So if I waited for almost 6 minutes, this would be done. So there we have your final scene. I hope you guys understood that, and I hope you will try that later on. So thank you, and yeah, goodbye, I guess.